Hey guys, what's up? And this is going to be another deck profile, and in this one we are going to be covering my take on the Luard deck. I finally have got this deck done, and I'm ready to show you guys what I have and how I've been playing it. I did not a whole lot of testing Saturday. I did get about 5 or 6 games in with it, and this is the way that it was, and there are a couple other things I want to do to it. The problem right now is Luard is very limited at the moment. With set 10 coming out, he's going to get more support. I'm pretty sure he'll get more support in set 11, and probably some in 12 too. You know, Bushiroad loves their Shadow Paladins. So I'm really looking forward to seeing where Luard can go by himself and not mixing him with other things. I'll get into it. There is some cards in here that the second there's a better option, I will drop. But anywho, let's just get straight into this. So for the starting Vanguard, we are playing Drag Prince Root. Has the Forerunner ability, and then Generation Break 1. When this unit is retired from the rearguard for the effect or cost of your card, you may counterblast one and put this card into your soul. If you do, choose one of your units and it gets plus 5,000 power until the end of turn. So this is really nice because you do use your soul quite a bit in Luard. So this card goes into the soul, so it gives you an extra card to soul blast. And it even gives one of your units another 5k. So it's pretty good. There's other starters you can use. Like some people use Creeping Dark Goat to search the top 5 for a grade 3, but I haven't had any problems getting a grade 3 into my hand, and I haven't had any problems getting specifically Luard into my hand. So I really don't see the point in playing anything but this. Until a new starter comes along that's better. So next, we play 4 Dead Crash Dragon, and 4 copies of Grim Reaper for 8 crits. Dead Crash will be coming out for the new Owl critical trigger when we get him in set 10. And speaking of Owls, for our draw trigger, we play 4 Howl Owl. His effect is obviously from the rear guard. You can put him into the soul and give one unit plus 3,000 power. Excuse me. Really good card to have because we do use our soul quite a bit. So the ability to put a card into the soul if we need it for a cost is a very good thing to have. I will admit, I'm also considering when the new Owl comes out to try the 12 crits, but I really am liking the draw triggers. I like draw triggers. Then we play our 4 heal triggers. I'm playing Abyss Grail. Because, you know, G-Guardians stuff. So that is our grade 0s. Our grade 1s. We're playing 4 copies of Drag Saver Esros. This is the Ritual Perfect Guard. You have ways of countercharging in this deck outside of playing the G-Guardian. I mean, not the G-Guardian, the G-Perfect Guards. I do have them. It's just I've been doing okay with these, and I really like this Perfect Guard. The ability to have this in the drop zone and then bring it back to your hand is really good, especially in a format where you want your Perfect Guards in the late game. So that's why I've been using these, and they've worked out fairly well. Next, we're playing 4 copies of Abyss Owl. Abyss Owl, when this unit is placed on the rear guard, you get to look at the top 7 cards of your deck and search for one card with Luard in its card name from among them and reveal it and put it into your hand and then shuffle your deck. If you put a card into your hand, choose one or more cards with the sum of their grades being 3 or greater from your hand and discard them. So, not bad. He's kind of like the new, like when the Stride Fodders let us search it out. He's just a little different. Then his other skill is Ritual 3. When this unit is retired from the rear guard, it, for the effect or cost of your card with Luard in its card name, countercharge 1. So that's really good. Next, we play 3 copies of Knight of Red Flash Ferdiad. I think that's how you say that. So, Ferdiad, ability Ritual 3 from the rear guard. When this unit is retired from the rear guard for the effect or cost of your card, choose one of your units and it gets plus 5,000 power until end of turn. So, I really like this because you can sack this off with Luard skill, get 2 more grade 1s, plus get a power boost. So, it's kind of like, it's like a grade 1 version of Root, actually. Very, very good card. And I also have a playset of the nice, the ones with the gold stamp on it, so that's nice. And then we have 2 copies of Drag Wizard Nice. Nice is a really good card because it helps you send cards into your drop zone to help you get to the ritual, you know, get your 3 grade 1s in the drop zone. Plus, it allows you to draw an extra card. And then also, her Ritual 3 effect is when she's placed on the rear guard from the deck, she gets plus 2,000 power, so the turn that she's called out, as long as, you know, you're calling her out from the deck, she gains 2,000 power, so she can be a 9k boost. And then I'm only using 1 copy of Blackwing Swordbreaker at the moment. I actually have an entire playset of this card, but I don't see the purpose in playing no more than 2 of this card, but your grade 1 space is actually pretty tight because you have so many good grade 1 choices. I thought about cutting 1 Ferdinand and playing 2 of him, 2 Nice, and 2 Swordbreaker, but you play Swordbreaker because you want to draw a card, but Nice kind of does that too, and you play draw triggers, I play draw triggers, so in a way, Swordbreaker at 1 is okay. You know, there's even some cases where I would even consider dropping Swordbreaker altogether. And obviously Swordbreaker, when she's called from the deck, Soul Blast 1 draw card. So. I might test play without her, just to see how it works. But right now, this grade 1 lineup is just fine. Grade 2s. First, we got 4 copies of one of the coolest cards for this deck, actually, is Drag Wizard Morphessa. I'm just in love with this card's artwork. Drag Wizard Morphessa, Ritual 3. When this unit attacks a Vanguard until the end of the battle, this unit gets plus 5,000 power. So she's a 14k attacker under Ritual, which is absolutely stupid. And then her other skill is when this unit's attack hits, you can counterblast 1. If you do, search your deck for up to 1 grade 1 card from your deck, call it to a rear guard, and shuffle your deck. And then her last ability is when she's in the drop zone, she is treated as a grade 1, which is even more dumb because she helps count toward Ritual. This card, believe it or not, I think was the most expensive card in the deck for the longest time, just because she is splashable in any Shadow Paladin deck that there is. Because, let's face it, getting 3 grade 1s in the drop zone is not hard. Next, we're playing 4 copies of Black Chain Flame Dance Formation Hoel. This card is in here mainly just because we do play Diablo Strides, and as much as I hate the Diablo archetype because I don't think it's good for the game, you really don't have a whole lot of options right now, and this is the best smart choice to go with. The grade 2 that came in the trial deck that's like Nice is bad. Yes, it attacks for 11 anytime you're under Ritual, but I just don't like that you have to use his skill in the main phase and you can't use it in the battle phase. If you could use it in the battle phase, that card would be a lot better. It actually would be pretty good. I would be playing 4 of it, but you can't, so there's... You have to go elsewhere. This guy is good. When your other grade 1 unit is placed on rear guard, if you have a vanguard with Diablo and its card names, choose up to one of your vanguards, and that unit and this unit gets plus 3,000 power until end of turn. So, whenever you go into either one of the Diablo strides, and you call out two units if you have a Luard Heart, both him and your vanguard will gain 6k. So, it's not bad. But, like, this will get dropped as soon as we get a better option. I really want the Grade 2 that lets you take a Grade 1 from the drop zone, put it on the bottom of the deck, and then it gains the power. As soon as I get four copies of that card, this card's gone. Next, and finally, we play three copies of Knight of Braun Grozny. This is one of my favorite cards for Shadow Paladin in general, and it was one of my favorite cards in my Claret Sword build. Ability, Generation Break 1. When your other unit with a grade less than this card is placed on the rear guard, this unit gets plus 3,000 power, so it stacks. So if he's on the field and you've already strode at least once, anytime you call a grade 1 or 0 unit, he gets plus 3,000 power. So under Luard's skill, he goes to 15. And, you know, with all the other superior calling you do of grade 1s in this deck, he's a pretty good call. So. But this deck is still in its early stages as far as, like, being, you know, getting its quality support. And then going into grade 3s, obviously, we have our four copies of Dragheart Luard. So, Dragheart Luard, Ritual 3, you can choose two normal units from your drop zone and put them on the bottom of your deck in any order. So, in other words, anything but a trigger. At the beginning of your ride phase, you may pay the cost. If you do, until the end of turn, you may stride without paying the cost next time you stride. So he allows you to have it's another way to stride. And, you know, that's incredible for the deck, and it's actually really unfair to everybody else. But. Oh, well. His other ability is, during your turn, when your G unit strides onto this card, you can counterblast one and sacrifice one of your rear guards. If you do, choose up to two grade one or less cards from your deck and call them to separate rear guard circles. So, next, two copies of Blasted Arc Diablo. He is in here mainly because this deck counterblasts quite enough, and I really didn't... You could make this Claret Sword, and I would, except for one small problem. I don't know where I put my Claret Swords. That's what this really would be. But then again, it does make sense right now to play this, as much as I hate to admit it, because, like I said, I hate the Diablo archetype. Because at least if you are on him and you can't stride and you don't have another grade 3, you can at least discard any card out of your hand and go into one of your Diablo strides. So it right now is the smart option. What I really wish Shadow Paladin had is I wish we had a dark version of Palamedes. Like Swordsman of the Explosive Flames Palamedes for Royal Paladin. I wish we had a Shadow Paladin version of that card. And then finally, for our last grade 3, we play two copies of Knight of Serial Blade Diamond. This is here mainly to help pick off, for your opponent to have to eat away their field. It's not in here just because of Diablo. It's in here because it works really well against formation decks, and you can really cripple your opponent's field very quickly if you know what you're doing. So, the difference between this card and Death Spray, you don't have to sacrifice one of your units, but you do have to counterblast one, and you get to pick the unit that is retired. This one, you just have to destroy one of your own units, and then your opponent chooses one of theirs. It's another one of those player preference things. When he does attack, he does go to 13, so that there is that, but other than that, you just have to decide whichever works best for you. Now, going into the G-Zone, right now is pretty boring because, like I said, we really don't have a whole lot of options. Set 10, we will get a a little more variety. So we'll I will do an updated deck profile on this once set 10 drops and I have all the support for it. But for right now, we're playing two copies of Dark Dragon, Carnivore Dragon. I've already talked about this card. I do not agree how it is ruled. But it is a good card. I'd be an idiot to say it isn't, because the way it's ruled is actually very unfair. Choose one of your rear guards and retire it, and then your opponent chooses two of his or her rear guards and retires them. If he or she could not retire two cards, choose up to three units in the front row, and they get plus 4,000 power. If your opponent only has one unit, you should not be able to force them to retire that one unit while still gaining 4,000 power. That is wrong. I'm sorry. I don't care who I gotta say that to. That is wrong. The way this card is written is not the way that comes across. If that's the way it was meant to come across, then Bushiroad, no offense, you need to be a little more clear in your fucking language, because the text on this card is absolute trash. It was not worded correctly. I'm sorry. And every set where we get two or three cards and they're misprinted is really starting to get annoying. Step up your game on that, for real. Next, we play four copies of Drag Driver Luard. Drag Driver Luard, the reason that you guys didn't see this deck profile for me immediately after set 9 dropped 2 months ago was because the people who did have this to trade, they were wanting 40 plus in trade value for one of the cards. And this card, to me, I am sorry, it is a good card as far as a first stride for Luard specifically, but this card is not as good as most people were wanting for him. I'm sorry. This card is good. It is a step in the right direction for Luard, but it is not the end-all be-all for Luard decks. And he's now finally reasonable, which is why I finally have my playset. But anyway, Ritual 3. Soul Blast 1. Choose a face-down card in your G zone and turn it face-up. When this unit is placed on the Vanguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, search for up to the number of Grade 1 cards from your deck equal to the number of Drag Driver Luard in your G zone that's face-up, and call them to separate rearguard circles, and then shuffle your deck. And for each Grade 1 card in your drop zone, the units called with this ability gain plus 1,000 power. So if you call... So whatever Grade 1s you call with his effect, if you have, say, 7 Grade 1s in the drop zone, the units that you called get 7,000 power each. that is... it is good, it's just... I would understand the amount of money people were asking for this if he somehow gained a crit, if you called, say, 3 units or something. But the way he is, I'm sorry, he was not worth what people were asking for him. I'm sorry. Next, we play two copies of Dark Dragon Spectral Blaster Diablo. This is the only Diablo card I actually really like, because it's based off Spectral Duke, and Spectral Duke was one of my favorite original old-school Vanguard cards. So, Spectral Blaster Diablo. Act ability. Soul Blast 1, choose a face-down card in your G-zone and turn it face-up, and then choose one of your rear guards and retire it. Until the end of turn, this unit gets, once per turn, Generation Break 3, Counterblast 2, and choose two of your rear guards and retire them. At the end of the battle that this unit attacked a Vanguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, you may stand this card, and it gets minus two drive until the end of turn. And if you have a heart card with Diablo in its card name, search your deck for up to one Grade 1 card, call it to rear guard, and shuffle your deck. I use it mainly just as a finisher, because you attack and you get to restand and then you attack again. This is the one Diablo card that I have that I actually like. I think playing him at 2 is a good idea. And then something I really, really hate myself for is we play 4 copies of Dark Dragon, Phantom Blaster, Diablo. You know what this card does. I'm not going to explain it. This card... I'm sorry, guys. Even with G-Guardians, this card got to be a lot... more balanced, because G Guardians are a new way of guarding without having to technically guard from the hand. But I'm sorry, there are certain decks that are finally getting a chance to be in the meta, like Pale Moon and Grand Blue, and, you know, they get punished by this card, and I just don't agree with it. I don't believe in any game ever there should be a card that says, if your opponent can't do this, then they are stuck. They can't do a thing. They basically just have to sit there and let you run over them. That is not fair. And I don't care who that makes mad. I don't care if that makes you choose to not watch me anymore. That's fine. But I do not agree with a card that basically says your opponent can't play the game. That is not fair. That is not healthy for the game, period. I don't care how you slice it. but, I mean, because this card will steal games just because your opponent is short on cards. That's not right. But, anywho, that's all I'm going to say. Lastly, we play four copies of Dark Dragon, Plotmaker Dragon. This is by far the best of the new G Guardians, with, like, no competition. Plotmaker, and his artwork is extremely amazing. Ritual 3, he gets 10,000 power. I mean, it is so easy. It is real easy to get three grade ones in your drop zone and have Ritual activated. So this card is really good. You have an easy 25k shield at all times. So really, really good. So, anywho, that is my Luard deck. I look very forward to the day when this can be, when we have cards that are sufficient enough to play pure Ritual Luard with nothing else in here at all. But right now, that is just not the case. The other two grade threes that we have that have the Ritual ability just are absolute garbage. I'm looking forward to seeing where this deck goes. This video may not have been what you wanted it to be, but I was giving you my honest opinion on the deck. It is a lot of fun to play. I will admit that. It's very successful. You'll win quite a bit with it. But I'm sorry. I just don't, like I said, guys, cards like this that just say, well, sorry, you lose because this card just was designed to steal games. I don't agree with it. If you're looking for a deck to go to a major event and do very well with, I'd be an idiot in saying that to not take this deck. It's the same stance that people take against Gear Chronicle. And I love Gear Chronicle, do not get me wrong. But the support that Gear Chronicle and Shadow Paladin have outranks so many other decks that, of course, they're going to do better just because they have more cards that are, quote-unquote, people say is broke and would be correct. That's all I'm going to say right now. So if you have any other questions about the deck, or you have any other questions just in general about anything regarding the deck as a whole, or you want my opinion on something, I'm always open to give my opinion. Just please respect it. I'm not going to name names. There have been people on my deck profiles before who will ask an opinion. I'll give it, and then I get yelled. I just get swarmed in the comment section for stating my opinion, and I've never done that to anybody. And it's just not. It's just. I'm sorry, it's just not right. I hope you enjoyed it anyway. So if you have suggestions for the deck, please feel free to leave those below. If you do have any other ideas on other ways on how to play the deck, please let me know. I'd love to hear them, actually. I'm really looking forward to, like I said, when this is just pure Luard, because just Luard as a card, I absolutely love it. When I very first saw the art of Luard, I knew immediately I wanted to play him, because He is a wizard that is just too cool. And he's a dragon wizard, which made me even like him more. So, I hope you guys enjoyed it, so make sure you leave a like, comment, and all that for me. If you did like it, if you have suggestions, please leave those as well. Hope you guys are all doing well wherever you might be, and I will see you next time.